Yep. Okay, we can begin. Everyone, welcome to the panel on queer and trans media. First of all, damn you to community media best practices and protest media and police media for stealing some of our thunder tonight with the audiences. But again, we will be live streaming this panel and it will be available online. For those of you that are presenting, again, remember you do have an audience, albeit a mostly internet one, but we've got some great participants today. For those of you out there, we're going to have three presentations today. They're going to be going out in 20-minute segments. At the end, we'll have a few clarification questions if necessary. But if not, we're going to steamroll until the very end when we'll have questions and kind of comments available at the end. I think the organizers of the conference were looking more for like a discussion kind of scenario. So feel free to kind of discuss topics amongst yourselves. I'll have a few questions in the chamber there, ready to shoot at you folks, just in case, just to get the ball rolling and the conversation started. So again, at the end, it'll kind of be a more opportunity for kind of bigger, broader questions, but if you do have any clarifying, please feel free to at the start. We're going to introduce our first speaker, a young man by the name of Luke Smith. Luke, do you want to come up? So Luke's presentation is called Queering the Airwaves, the Challenges Facing Gender and Sexual Minorities in Community Radio. Luke Smith will be exploring what barriers folks who are gender and sexual minorities face when engaging with radio as a platform. With radio being run by, like an old boys club, I see you've been to CGSF radio before, it is still a difficult space to break into. Radio industry also has no legal federal protections for trans folks, making their work on this platform very precarious. Luke's going to demonstrate how for radio stations to have GLBT plus programming, for them to do that is inherently political. And by queering the airwaves and subverting what is considered normal, we can create and enlarge the spaces for different folks to feel comfortable to make their voices heard. The aim is to show that creating spaces where being queer is visible and more normative helps foster engagement, but more importantly, a source of community. It's going to draw on some history of the Velvet Studios as well as other Canadian examples. And Luke, I hope I didn't just basically do your presentation during the bio intro. But without further ado, Luke.
Excellent. Thank you. I totally may have not put way too much detail in that. And you're telling me my presentation. I'm like, wow, it sounds fantastic. Who wrote it? It's like, clearly it's not. A guy in radio, you'd think I'd know how to handle a mic. So, anyway, my name is Luke Smith. Thank you all for being here, and I'm looking forward to the conversations later on. I think it'd be fantastic. I work with the National Campus and Community Radio Association. We represent 95 radio stations across the country, and I volunteer with my radio show, The Velvet Studio, in CKCU Carlton, but we're also syndicated in other stations across the country as well. Also one of the only Canadian stations that cover this. In fact, we did a survey of the not-for-profit radio sector asking how many folks cover GLBT topics in their programming, and out of 95 stations, only 14 programs exist, and 7 of them are at CKUT. So congratulations, Montreal, you dominate the scene, but it's really sad that there is so little programming even within the community sector. And the commercial sector is a completely different beast. So these are some of the things. Okay, here we go. These are some of the things that I'm hoping to cover, but we probably won't have time to do it all. But I'm really looking forward to discussing fisting at 1 p.m., which is quite an interesting conversation. So that should be quite something. So as I mentioned, we're one of only 14 GLBT shows. There may be one or two more. Queer Q. KWIR just kicked up in CFMH, which is St. John, New Brunswick, and they're looking at trans issues in the East Coast, which is quite exciting. And it was created about 4 years ago to fill in a gap, and I'll talk about the creation and the motivation behind producing this kind of content in a few minutes. But looking at what options there are and kind of why we were inspired to bring more voices to the table, you have to look at what is already available. And currently, Proud FM is essentially the only thing, the only option that we have. And I mean, if you want to listen to Elton John and Adam Lambert and Lady Gaga on repeat, then it's certainly the station for you. But it has very little spoken word programming. The spoken word programming it does have very rarely takes anything seriously, which is a worry. They have a platform and an audience, but they're not tackling any topics that would be of import. So why is there a need for gay spaces, not just gay faces? So SiriusXM recently shut down OutQ, which was the GLBT channel on the satellite system. Sirius is the only satellite service operating in Canada, and they have a number of channels. But they decided to shut down OutQ, which was the GLBT channel, and insisted that what they've done is dispersed those folks across all of their other channels, so there are GLBT people in multiple shows. Now, there's certainly a benefit to normalizing gay voices, normalizing those experiences in other shows, so it's not specifically just the gay space. But it's also important to have somewhere to go where you know the content is reflective of your community, that you can go and you know that conversations will be around the topics that reflect the folks that you spend time with in a way that is constructive, knowledgeable, but still answers some important questions. Where are we? Yes. So we created the show Three Gays on the Radio following the loss of Jamie Hubley. So this was around the time that there was a string of teen suicides in the States. It was dominating the news. You know, you couldn't go a day without hearing about some new horror story coming out of the States. And then Ottawa was struck by the tragedy. And I remember having a conversation with my good friend Sebastian, and I was doing a politics show at the time. And he was saying that when he was younger, he volunteered at a station, and his co-host when he was younger, he made me specify the difference, but his friend when he was younger would tell his mother and father that he's going out for a drive to practice his driving skills, and he would go all of half a block into the Max Milk parking lot, and he'd sit there and he'd listen to the show for an hour, and it was in Guelph this show was based, and it was the GLBT show, and for him that's how he connected to the community. This guy wasn't out of the closet, he wasn't out to his family, but the way that he felt connected and normal was by engaging with this radio show, by driving all of 5 minutes down the road and parking outside of Max Milk. And I thought that was such a wonderful story that, I mean, there is no way to know that if these kinds of programming existed, would it have had an impact on Jamie? Who knows? But we hope that by providing these experiences and providing other examples which aren't just Proud FM, that we can help to provide some kind of alternative to young folks. Oh dear. Okay. So I do have a news clip, but it works. I'm not going to go through those postings. I'll probably glaze over these because I assume you folks know the differences between homonormative and heteronormative. But before we get into this, I'm going to lighten the mood with a good story that came out of Jamie Hubley passing. There was another individual in Gatineau, which is just across the river, and Jamie Hubley had a blog. And if you looked at his Tumblr page, it was a rapid decline in mental health, and it was more and more suicide ideation in his postings, and then sadly we lost him. But there was another guy, same age, 14, in Gatineau, and same blog pattern. But the internet rallied around this individual and, you know, really demonstrated overwhelming support. And the individual is now doing ballet and leaving a very happy life. If his Twitter is anything to go by. So it was really thrilling to see this massive U-turn in the community. It's unfortunate that what preceded it, but it was really great. So, yes. So one of the questions that I wanted to look at is whose voices are being represented? And that's where I think I'm going to touch on, homonormativity. So what's the normal gay? What's the standard? I mean, I really am a terrible example to be speaking about this as a cisgendered white male in my mid-20s, employed, all that jazz. My backpack is pretty goddamn heavy, to say the least. So there are certain issues that are dominating the conversations. Marriage equality is dominating, but who gets married? People who can afford to get married. So there's a class issue there. There's discussions around assimilation into heteronormative culture. So these are the voices that tend to dominate the scene. I put this one in because it shows the blatant racism on Grindr, where it says no chocolate or rice. Like, and this happens. I looked in Aurelia because that's what people do, and there wasn't any racist profiles in Aurelia, so good job, folks. Well done. I'm very happy about that. But we see this homonormative system develop into what's being called the A-gaze. So the epitome of the homonormative model, they're affluent, they're white, they have a six-pack, and it really others a lot of other people. And this is what's being targeted by Proud FM. If you look at the advertising around Toronto Pride a year or so ago, it was very much geared around this kind of imagery. So understanding the A-gaze is kind of it lets you see what's dominating mainstream media. And once you know who's being targeted, you can begin to understand who's being excluded from that. So applying the queer lens, are you folks familiar with the queer lens? That would save some time. So if somebody's passingly familiar. So I actually applied this to international relations, which was a very interesting mission. But it is derived out of the gender lens and the feminist lens, and it's a critical analysis. But it's a way of looking at what is excluded, and it's weird because it even questions what the lens itself is. Like, it's very hard to define, because to define it would be to put it in a box, and it's inherently unboxable. So it's very difficult to explain, and I am not in the program to do it enough justice. But what I wanted to do is really look at what is being represented and what is being excluded as a result. So when GLBT culture is being represented in radio, it's very often being token examples. It's very often, if there are GLBT voices, they're overwhelmingly white, overwhelmingly cisgendered, affluent. These are all things that are the voices that are being represented in there. That was the original team that put the show together a few years ago. So when we're queering the radio, we need to be very careful as to whose voices we're engaging, whose voices we're empowering to take leadership roles, and not just in terms of who's hosting it. And we've actually really struggled in Ottawa to find voices which aren't white, because the city is unfortunately very much so. But really looking at the guests, looking at the topics that are being discussed. Are these people, are we mansplaining a topic, or are we providing a platform for people to speak to these issues themselves? And how are these topics being framed, and how are they being put, wrong way, whoops-a-daisy, and how are they being portrayed? Sorry if anyone gets nauseated from the swooshing. So setting that aside for a second, I want to touch briefly on creating an accessible space if you are producing radio. I am not trans-identified and cannot speak to folks who are trans-identified. But I can speak to the lobbying efforts that the NCRA are doing. Currently, under federal law, gender identity and gender expression are not protected under the Canadian Federal Human Rights Code, and radio is regulated at the federal level, similar to the armed forces and canals and lighthouses, for some weird reason. But the point being that if you are in the radio sector, you can still legally be discriminated against for being trans across the entire country. So for us, it was important to work with the Trans Equality Group, which is being led by Gender Mosaic, the country's oldest trans organization, EGAL Canada and Amnesty International, to really push for the addition of that. Last year, we saw Bill C-279, Gender Identity, Gender Expression Bill, was defeated when the House rose and it just died on the order paper. To give people some scope, that exact bill in one form or another has been on the books since the bill that decriminalized homosexuality. Like, it's been there a long time and it's never passed. We've been promised that the Liberals are introducing legislation in the next couple of months, and we're hoping it'll pass by the end of the year. In CFMH, I was talking to my good friend Stephanie, who will be co-presenting with me in a month. She was telling me about how, when she began to work at CFMH, that what made her feel most at home straight away was using the correct pronouns from the get-go and just making it a non-issue, making it, you know, not being awkward and creating barriers and so on, and, you know, casually mentioning that there's a single stall washroom down the hall, and kind of creating those an environment that's not only accepting but also very welcoming. I can't remember which way the arrow goes. Is it this one? Okay, cool. So I'm not going to delve too much into this because it's going to be covered in another one. But, you know, so if you are doing radio, I would suggest identifying where the nearest single stall washrooms are, or gender neutral washrooms. 5 minutes? Okay, cool. But it's important that right now the debate is being talked about in the States very heavily. I'm not going to go into too much detail, only to point out that the politics of passing is coming up. So, you know, the arguments are being made that folks should use the washrooms they're identified as. And the imagery and the voices are being highlighted are the images and the voices of folks who are very passing, that are very convincingly of the other gender. This is a young trans girl who's dominated the news recently. And someone took a photo and said, you know, why would you put this individual in the men's washroom? Which is a good point, but it undermines the idea of it being an identity, and instead kind of creates a beauty standard for folks to pee, which is sort of ridiculous when you think about it. So we wanted to make sure that we quickly address that. So how and why do I talk about anal fisting at 1 p.m.? And I was like, that's because it did happen. We did discuss anal fisting at 1 p.m. I did cringe. But in the UK, the government was concerned that people are having more anal sex. And it was a very serious report that they released. And they were very serious about it. And they wanted to introduce legislation to kind of curb the behavior. And obviously it was newsworthy. It was a conversation. But would this ever have come up on Hot 89 or Country FM? I very much doubt it. But what it did is it allowed for a space in the conversation around that. Now, community radio is not regulated by the Canadian Broadcast Standards Council, but all commercial radio is. And it's an industry body, not a legally empowered regulator. So this is the only thing that regulates what you can and cannot say. So unduly sexually explicit material, or unduly coarse, thank you, or offensive language. So I'm going to move quickly along. So there really is very few limitations. So what is left to talk about? You know, in Canada, we have equal marriage, we have adoption, we have, you know, everything should be hunky-dory and fine. Well, there is still so many conversations to have. Every single week, we're able to come up with a new topic, and we've got an agenda lined out until June. You know, there's the trans rights legislation I mentioned, Hazim Ismail's Malaysian refugee status, people talk about Iran and the Rainbow Railroad, but we don't talk about other countries such as Malaysia. Homelessness in GLBT youth. There is phenomenal amounts of homelessness in urban centers, and they're overwhelmingly GLBT. Violence against folks and hate crimes, which are chronically underreported. Or the arson attack on the clinic for top surgery, the only one of its kind in the country. So there are Canadian stories that can be discussed, which are not being discussed by mainstream media, because these are the voices that are being othered and separated. And it's about real representations of people, having representations that are authentic, that are real folks in the street. We're seeing a trend now to diverse representations, and these are just two things I'm looking forward to being released very soon. And this is the last one. But we need more representations, and we need more of these voices on the air. I mentioned earlier at the top of the hour that there's only 14 shows in the country, well, now 15. And DJ Adele Roberts, who's on the BBC Morning Show, but to give you context, that is the most popular show in the United Kingdom on radio, is the Morning Show, except for maybe the Top 40 Countdown. But if Adele Roberts is saying that she knows folks who are too uncomfortable to come out, then that really speaks to a worrying problem within radio, that folks aren't comfortable being who they are. And if you're not comfortable being who you are, how are you able to bring other representations to the table and bring other voices to the table to cover these very topics which are currently being silenced? So there we go. That was it.
All right. Thank you, Luke. Thank you. So again, this is not the time to blow it open with a broad spectrum, but did anyone have any specific questions related to Luke's presentation about the content? Going to do a little long scan here. Okay, well, thank you, Luke. You are out Excellent. Of the hot seat.
Excellent, thank you.
Yes. And out of the frying pan to the fire. Up next, we have another wonderful little presentation. It's called No More Potlucks. It's a peer review representation and rejection by Mel Hogan and Andrea Zephyro. All right. So Mel and Andrea are co-editors of nomorepotlucks.org. They will be discussing that project, its history, and the curatorial process. In the form of an informal conversation with us, they will discuss ownership of queer culture and issues relating to peer review, representation, and rejection. Take it away.
Do we have to speak into this?
You don't have to, but it'll help for the live stream.
Okay.
So.
Thank you for that introduction.
Thanks, everyone, for being here. That was a great presentation,
yes.
And I think it will resonate a lot with ours.
I see a lot of connections, actually, so that's fabulous.
So how many people have heard of No More Potlucks? You have? You have? Just for those who haven't, I'm going to click on this link here and pull it up just quickly. Just to give you an idea. Going to talk about its history a little bit, but we have quite a few issues. We're at issue 44 now, basically a bunch of articles, interviews, things like that. So you can look through it. Just want to show you. Oh, no, it's not cute.
Okay. So thank you for that introduction. It outlines basically what we'll be addressing today, because there's sort of infinite possibilities in terms of how we could frame a discussion around NMP. So we're going to address those key points, and sort of keep a conversational tone. Sandra had reached out to us and asked us if we wanted to present on this in a formal context, and we jumped at the occasion. So we're using this opportunity, and like I said, I think there's links in terms of what Luke was talking about, and just based on Andy, your description, I think we'll be able to have a really productive conversation on the issues that we're all addressing, right? So I guess we'll frame NMP sort of in a historical context, and I'll.
So just a quick historical overview. We actually grew out of radio, community radio, Dykes on Mics in Montreal, one of the 14
gay, lesbian, queer show. What's that?
Yeah,
well,
one of the,
from,
yeah,
which
yeah.
I just learned about.
I guess one of the seven out of the 14.
One of the seven, 14. And so basically there were three of us hosting the show. I mean, this show's the longest running lesbian radio show in Canada, possibly in the world. So at the time there's MC McPhee, Dana McLeod, and I were the sort of the team. And we thought, okay, radio is great, and we were really considering how to sort of make radio last beyond sort of that live moment of radio, which we sort of got into when we started thinking about podcasting and the activists archive in relation to the sort of the preservation of the show beyond sort of that live 2-hour slot that we had. And so we also thought, well, maybe we could take this experience, because when you're in radio, you're also generally, and I don't know if it's true for all community radio, but you do all of the programming. So you develop a huge network, which then we thought, well, we could sort of tap into this network and create an online journal.
Which at the time was still, right? That was 2007 years ago, 2009.
Yeah, so in 2009, I mean, now we think of these online journals, like who doesn't have an online journal? But 2009, 7 years ago, this was still kind of a new and interesting idea. Not to say it's not today, but it was a little... We had fewer models, I guess, and the inspiration sort of really came from radio rather than other journals.
There's less templates, I guess, too, right? And technologically speaking.
Yeah, so I'll get to that. So so basically when we started, we dug this out of the Wayback Machine, but basically when we first started, it was all coded in HTML. I had just gone to like a graphic design school and was like, great, I can apply my awesome skills, as you can see. So what we did was create just an HTML, sort of bare bones, but at the time, before it was a journal, it was sort of a... what did we call this? Like a posting board of events in Montreal for queer women. And this is what quickly morphed into this journal idea. And then basically we did a bunch of content management systems, a bunch of templates. We went from text pattern to Drupal, and we finally settled on WordPress. And just a quick word about WordPress is that it kind of looks good out of the box. It's easy to manage, and it's easy to team manage. And so there are pros and cons to this, which we'll get to in a little bit. But this is sort of the current iteration. It is not perfect, but it is sort of, for all the things that it does for you, pretty pretty amazing. And then the other thing that we had. So the other thing that we have that is quite special and that we did from the very beginning, so from issue one, is that we also made the issues into print. And No More Potlucks is actually the first and maybe still only print-on-demand journal at Library Archives Canada. So that's very cool. And it means that if you're low budget or no budget, as we are, we never got funding. We never got any sort of financial support. So basically what this means is if people want a copy of the journals, they get one directly from this company called Lulu. It's print and bound and shipped to your house directly. So, again, just allows us to do so much more than would have been possible, 10 years ago.
Yeah. So as Mel mentioned, it's basically we operate it without any kind of financial support. So it's entirely volunteer run from sort of the curatorial collective that we have, which is... Mel and MC McPhee, which were original founders, and then myself, and all of our volunteers. So we have copy editors, a team of contributors, a few that repeat contributors, and then people that just come into the journal. So that's kind of important. I mean, we'll address it later as well. Like that's sort of a decisive stance that we've decided that. Not seeking funding means that we're able to like basically not have an institutional affiliation elsewhere, but then in claiming that, then that means that really it is all free labor, right, that we input to it. So that's something that we're constantly negotiating, especially when there really are just three of us that are managing the day-to-day. And recently, you know, in part in sort of realizing our own limitations, right? Because your life changes and you have different kinds of responsibilities outside of projects. We decided to go to. Are we at four issues? So it started out. Was it monthly?
So we should probably say that we put out an issue every 2 months. So in terms of labor, and usually they're about 100, 80 to 100 pages. So,
And that involves. So we seek out contributors. So the way the journal we should actually backtrack slightly. So the journal is organized around themes. So we have themes that then become the crux of each journal issue. So for instance, our last issue was Reflect. And so we invite people to submit to that issue, and they can engage with the theme, you know, in indirect ways, creative ways, however it is that they see their work fitting into that. So that's sort of how we organize the content. But it was, wasn't it monthly when it first started?
Or? No,
it was always bi-monthly. Okay, so now we're 4 months because of just sort of where we are in terms of our own, you know, work outside of the journal itself. And so what's important in terms of what we do as, and we use the word curator as opposed to editor, because we see in part that role as being about shaping the issues, right? So it's less about editing content or, you know, taking what's been submitted and then turning it into something that we see fitting into the journal, and more about sort of curating these kinds of submissions, right, based on these themes. So that's an important demarcation there. And it really goes into sort of this idea of community, like who are we to decide, even we're constantly questioning who are we to decide, you know, what is supposed to be in the journal, what shouldn't be in the journal. And we never really realize that kind of responsibility, you know, that we sort of butt up against that.
So maybe just to pick up on that issue, and I think it came, you know, out a lot also in the presentation before ours, is this idea of, you know, maybe radio being sort of a male-dominated space in some ways. We're also three white curators of this journal, and then, you know, at first that's okay. It's just kind of like our little project, but then as it becomes more sort of like with 44 issues in, it takes on its own momentum and it becomes its own sort of community. And then the responsibility of how to curate that, again, this question of voice and representation was quite huge. And our first cover was this one. This was the birth issue. And it was sort of, you know, I think a great image for who gets to speak for queer in terms of gender representation, in terms of race, and all sorts of other categories, right? So it's sort of like this risk that you take. And what we did based on this, you know, this particular image that for sure does not represent everyone or possibly anyone, was that we decided we can't just have images. They don't circulate that well or, you know, sort of without problems. So what we did sort of from issue 2 to 44 is that we made sure to contextualize those images, have interviews with each photographer, because images on their own can tell very sort of, you know, different kinds of stories to different kinds of people. So so I guess we were also learning as we were going. And so you can see now with 44 issues, sort of the, in some ways, the many, many covers, the 44 covers tell a much greater story than one image on its own can. And I think, well, you can judge for yourself sort of, you know, what kind of story that is.
Mm-hmm. So part of, you know, our process in terms of what we do for curating is, and we've learned this as we've been going along, that we have to go outside of our own understanding of community or social network. So the journal itself, I mean, when it was launched online, it was physically launched out of Montreal, right? That's sort of where the project was taking off. And now we're all dispersed. And in fact, we have to seek out other geographical locations, right? So there is an effort to, you know, if it's Canadian content, well, that doesn't just mean Montreal or Toronto. And in fact, there are a lot of folks that live in Montreal and Toronto that, you know, fit into and contribute to NMP. So we have to make an effort to really make those connections outside of those centers.
And maybe just one more note, when we sort of wrote this conversational piece between the two of us, we were thinking of Queer by the Archive also, mm-hmm. sort of as this way in which all submissions are, you know, invariably queered by being an NMP. And we were starting to think, well, who counts as queer? Is that important? Are we watering down the whole, you know, sort of queer mission that was initially the inspiration for the journal? And sort of really starting to grapple with sort of the effects of having pieces in an issue curated alongside each other and what that did to other pieces and how that represented mm-hmm. More generally.
And in part, you know, it speaks a little bit to what Luke was talking about this lens, right? That, and for us, I think it's not just it's not just about the content itself, that it's the community, it's also the querying of community technology and labor, right? Mm-hmm. All of these elements come together to really build this composite understanding of, I guess, a queer community.
And I like what Luke said about gay spaces versus gay faces, and I would add to that sort of the gay network, right, as sort of immaterial as that might be. Oh, okay, so just so one example of this template idea is that, so I would say there were maybe two sort of offshoots or, you know, I don't know, inspiration or versions of NMP that started circulating that we noticed later on. So this journal is called Feral Feminisms. I don't know if people know it, you know it. So this was essentially most of the editors have been in NMP, and so they launched this journal that is using the exact same template as NMP without any sort of reference to it. And it's essentially the same sort of mandate, more academic. And then we started to wonder, well, is that sort of, you know, is that in terms of queer ownership of ideas and networks, is that okay? Is that actually really great? Is that what we're hoping for? NMP, yeah, go do your own journal if there's stuff we're not touching on, because we don't ultimately want to be responsible for all forms of representation and format. So, do we have this queer expectation? Well, no, you should have like a little nudge to us, and we should have some sort of relationship or, you know, more formal or visible connection. And then another one that was more, this collective out of Oregon actually came to us at NMP and said, we want to launch a journal, you guys do it, and in this way, that's interesting, could we do it? In the end, they ended up doing it completely differently, but it was a sort of a nice acknowledgement of sort of what came before. And so maybe...
Mm-hmm. I think sort of this is an example for me. I have a bit of a background in academic publishing, journal publishing in particular. So I think, Ada, this example sort of straddles the academic and then also the ethos of NMP, where here they're really trying to break down certain elements of academic publishing. So, for example, like the peer review process, where they've instituted an open peer review process where you can actually see what is happening in this context. And just to speak a little bit about sort of the academic, non-academic context, you know, in like as I was saying, in terms of a curatorship or an editorialship, you know, we made this decision not to seek out any kind of institutional support or funding support, which means that we get to claim it in a certain way. And, you know, often you can think about in an academic context or other kinds of formalized context where you have to respond to an editorial board, for instance, where, you know, content that maybe we want to feature doesn't necessarily align with the expectations of an editorial board or a larger, makeup of individuals that run certain kinds of publications. And we also have, you know, in the past, people sort of asked us about how NMP relates to an academic context, as though we kind of have to, as academics, that we need to claim it in certain ways or bring it into our own fields of study in certain ways. And in the past, we've sort of responded that, you know, maybe that it's not important for us to theorize it. And we've done it in other contexts, right? We've written pieces, I was for a social justice anthology about NMP and thinking through the kinds of tensions that we're addressing. But maybe, you know, it's the doing that's more important than the theorizing. So when we bring it into academic context, that we really make clear the process and the elements that go towards building this community. I don't know, I think it's some attention that we grapple with as well. And, you know, at times when we're working with certain communities or authors or contributors, there's an expectation of openness in the sense that if something is submitted, then it should automatically be published because of the model that we've just described to you. And so that also then brings up issues around, I guess.
Well, yeah, I guess maybe just like two words on, or two examples of rejection. One is this idea that, you know, as we're curators, we're sort of in charge of what gets published and then gets to be part of this community and promoted in that way. And that's, you know, even though the end product sort of has this sort of slick finality to it, it's something we struggle constantly with and are a little bit burdened by, because when you curate, it is sort of based on, you know, a decision by three people, and it's not the ultimate sort of, you know, decision of whether a piece is good or not. But, you know, end of day, we do the labor and we take responsibility for sort of the connections between the pieces. So we have to say no to people. The flip side of that is because we have these one-word themes. One example is when at one point we had failure as a theme. We have very dark themes. It's just
somehow
it's just what we do. But so we had failure, and we always invite artists and academics and activists to challenge those themes and to subvert them or to roll with them, whatever. But we actually got rejected at some point saying, I don't want my work associated with failure. Are you kidding me? Like, this is problematic in so many ways. So fair enough,
which
right?
Which is amazing, because
so,
we hadn't even thought of
right.
You know,
so,
the themes in that way.
Yeah, so again, so all the pushback that we get and sort of the rejection is very informative in terms of how we then process certain things. So so those are just obviously two little examples, but I think they sort of... For me, it's just an opportunity to talk about NMP and how, you know, just sort of the discomfort and all the conversation that is happening behind the scene that you don't often hear about. So we had a bunch of questions. Okay, good, it's back. So just sort of to wrap it up, I don't know, we're probably close to time, but, you know, this is...
Maybe we can pick it up certainly after.
Yeah, yeah. These are not questions to be answered right now, but it's just, again, to sort of reiterate the idea that you know, it's sort of a big job. It feels, you know, we start sort of wondering about the meaning of queer ownership, and you know, should we be thinking of it in terms of kinship or other models? And then what are our responsibilities to one another within, you know, within this journal context, but also, you know, and linked to community radio and to other things. Yeah. And then how does this become, can it become activism? Is it already activism? You know, with sort of the you know, the changes that have happened, does this journal have the same impact as it would have had, you know, 30, 40 years ago? Mm-hmm. No. And then how do we account for communities with different ideals and needs? And then as I guess we're all saying, around issues of representation, access, and voice.
Yeah.
And then what, if anything, do we owe one another? And how should we curate our lives? And then because we're kind of obsessed with the archive, how does this sort of inform the potential or the archive of the future? Those are not questions to be answered now, but maybe we'll find out.
All right, thank you very much. Are there any specific questions related to this presentation? Again, we're going to get into the more discursive element in a bit. Anyone? Okay. Seeing none, we're going to move to our final presentation before we get into the little Q&A discussion. This next piece is called Occupati, Queering Public Bathrooms Through Direct Action, and Andy Shabar is going to be taking it on. Is that right, Shabar?
Shabar,
sorry. So, gender-segregated public bathrooms are often a site of violence for trans, non-gender-conforming, and queer folks. Aside from human interactions, non-human elements of public restrooms, including architecture, acoustics, aesthetics. Michael Foucault is loving this discussion, I can tell you.
He's not
going to affect the way bodies move, feel, think, act in this highly contested space. How do direct media actions address and disrupt the congealing of heterosexual hegemony in this space? Addressing this question, this paper explores how direct media actions, including queer bathroom graffiti and subversive bathroom selfies posted on social media, have the potential to confront, expose, and transform various modes of gender surveillance that operate in and around public restrooms. Central to this discussion is considering how queer activisms produce community based on anonymity, ephemera, and effect in order to reimagine creative ways to queer public bathrooms. Andy, take it away.
I didn't realize that was going to be read aloud, so thank you for reading all of that. Okay, so my presentation's a bit more formal, but hopefully we can have an informal discussion at the end with all the other great presentations. So I've been documenting and writing on queer activism in and around gender-segregated bathrooms for about 5 years now. Most of my work in this area centers on queer bathroom graffiti and its political potentials. However, new creative forms of activism have begun to surface with the recent passage of the North Carolina Public Facilities Privacy and Security Act, otherwise known as House Bill 2 or HB 2. This law sanctions state discrimination against LGBTQ people by not recognizing gender identity and sexual orientation as classes of people that deserve protection against discrimination. In effect, the law prohibits trans people from using public bathrooms that correspond to their gender identity. Some creative activist responses have included squat-ins or shit-ins, where groups physically occupy gender-segregated bathrooms, defacing normative corporate advertising in the stalls, creating and installing unsanctioned gender-neutral signposts outside bathrooms or inconspicuously switching them around, taking selfies that illustrate the sheer ridiculousness but also seriousness of trans discriminatory legislation, and then sharing them on social media, so I'll get back to this a little bit later, and of course, bathroom graffiti. These emergent activisms are different from street marches, rallies, and mainstream media lobbying because they occupy the actual site that's under contestation. They seek to expose, disrupt, and transform homophobic, transphobic, and regulatory space through collaborative community direct action. That is not to say that more conventional forms of protest aren't useful. Indeed, they are necessary partners to these guerrilla activisms. The public bathroom is an iconic space in queer culture. It is a place of queer pleasure, but also of queer pain. For many, including myself, public bathrooms have been a site for hookups, cruising, and queer sex. However, bathrooms are increasingly becoming a place of hostility where violence against trans, gender non-conforming folks, and queer sexuality occurs. Typically, North American public bathrooms are designed in ways that allow the public to police and surveil gender and sexuality. Often trans people are denied entry to public bathrooms through discriminatory laws such as HB 2, harassment, and or threats of assault. As Jack Halberstam, who's a queer theorist, points out, the bathroom problem increases for gender ambiguous men and women, but even more so for trans people who are often met with hostility in this public space. While some genderqueers may be able to escape gender policing's watchful eye by passing, and we talked about passing in the first presentation, as either male or female, others may have a harder time, especially if they identify outside of the rigid male-female gender binary. Therefore, genderqueers who don't identify with either gender are forced to closet their gender or non-gender in public bathrooms and perform a subjectivity that's alien to their own. For this reason, restrooms are avoided. As a consequence, the number of bladder-related health issues is disproportionately high within the trans and queer community. Acknowledging the psychological and physiological harms of bathroom policing on trans people, the Charlotte City Council in this past February, passed an ordinance banning discrimination based on gender identity and or sexual orientation. The ordinance was to take effect last April, and it extended North Carolina's state discrimination laws to prevent businesses from discriminating against their LGBT customers. The existing rules of North Carolina state at the time the ordinance was filed provided protection to customers based on race, age, religion, and gender. Charlotte's ordinance was important because it expanded the category of gender to include gender identity and sexual orientation, thereby protecting trans people who use the bathroom that correspond to the gender with which they identify. So almost immediately, Republicans in the state legislature overturned the ordinance in March. HB 2 was filed and passed on the same day by Pat McCrory, who's the state governor of North Carolina. HB 2 not only strikes down Charlotte's ban, it also prevents any local governments from passing their own non-discrimination ordinances. And it also mandates that students in state schools must use the bathroom that corresponds to the gender noted on their birth certificate. In fact, HB 2 set a new statewide definition of classes of people who are protected against discrimination. These classes include, quote, race, religion, color, national origin, age, handicap, or biological sex as designated on a person's birth certificate, end quote. So the gender category was removed, which prevents cities and counties and private businesses from establishing a different standard of gender discrimination to protect their own LGBT communities. This past Monday, the U.S. Department of Justice sued Governor Pat McCrory and the North Carolina Department of Public Safety for violating the Civil Rights Act, the Federal Civil Rights Act, as well as the Violence Against Women Act, which both prohibit discrimination based on sex and gender identity. So the in the lawsuit, the Department of Justice states that HB2 stigmatizes and singles out trans people. It also states that trans men are men and trans women are women, which is obviously a very important point that's been looked over in the wording of HB2. The document goes, so McCrory responded by filing two countersuits rather than conceding with the Department of Justice against the U.S. government, claiming that the Justice Department's position is, quote, a radical reinterpretation of Civil Rights Act. So although the U.S. Attorney General, Loretta Lynch, who gave a really great speech, and you should check it out if you haven't already, she publicly stated that she would not back down from protecting the civil rights of LGBT people. Many states, politicians, and members of the public, however, loudly support the transphobic bill. So you see this especially online, where you have all these people coming out of the woodworks, making blog posts or trolling news articles in the comment section, giving their unsolicited transphobic opinions on the debate. Even more disturbing, right-wing religious groups have threatened to send their male members into women's public bathrooms to harass women as a way to prove the dangers of the bill. There was even a threat made by an evangelical pastor to pee on the floor in the middle of Target to protest Target's trans-inclusive bathroom policy. I'm not sure how that works. These types of backlashes, while certainly bizarre, heighten the optics of hostility and the potential violent attacks against trans folks. So those who forcefully oppose anti-discrimination bathroom laws make unfounded arguments, including claims that pedophiles would be protected in bathrooms, that women who have been abused might feel uncomfortable around trans women who have biologically male characteristics, and that overall, the violence against women in public bathrooms would increase exponentially. So not only are these arguments rooted in paternalistic and sexist notions, they also perpetuate transphobic views about what the category woman is and who it applies to. So this cis-sexist definition of woman erases from the conversation transgender women and their experiences of violence in public bathrooms. So more than just a concern for cisgender women's safety, the controversy over bathroom bills reveals this cultural anxiety about the consequences of what is hopefully becoming a slowly eroding gender binary. So HB2 has caused numerous corporations to pull out of future plans to develop in the state. Celebrities, professional athletes, musicians, film companies, and even other states who condemn the bill have cut their support and or refused to travel to North Carolina, and that is putting the state's economy in jeopardy. There are ongoing rallies and protests by North Carolinians, which often result in shutting down legislative buildings and blocking public streets. Even a pornographic website, X-Hamster, took action against HB2 by denying North Carolina IP addresses to access the site. Then they allowed access. However, they created this pop-up so that whenever North Carolinians who visit the site are met with this, and it contains some stats on how much gay and trans porn is actually accessed from the site, So a little pushback there. While sanctioned protests such as these are undeniably important, have real political effects, I'm interested in some of the more transgressive, direct media actions that happen in the bathroom itself. What are some of the grassroots activisms ignored by mainstream media? What are their autonomous strategies and tactics? And how do they transform the way gender and sexuality is experienced and felt in public bathroom space? So hashtag OccuPotty is a social media campaign that exposes and confronts the bathroom discrimination. The hashtag is found alongside selfies taken in public restrooms in order to raise awareness on the whole bathroom bill debate. So images are often tagged with not only just occupati, but also we just need to pee, letter people pee, or plet put me here, which refers to Bill C 279. So Bray Carnes, who is a Canadian trans woman, started a selfie protest, started this whole movement, actually. She began posting a series of pictures of her applying lipstick, striking a pose, holding a sign against a wall of urinals. And she gained some international coverage with her selfies and told reporters from the Times, I'm giving them what they want. I'm actively showing them what it would look like if this became law and how completely ridiculous it is. Likewise, Michael Hughes, a trans man living in Minnesota, which is also undergoing similar bathroom bill debates right now, started posting under the hashtag Occupati with pictures of himself in women's restrooms with captions like, do I look like I belong in the women's facilities? The social media campaign has gained significant traction in the queer and trans community. On Instagram alone, there are 150 images tagged with Occupati and 845 with We Just Need to Pee. So we can talk about maybe in the discussion of who's again represented in these photos and how is passing coming up in these representations. These subversive selfies allow those most affected by the bathroom debate to be heard and seen, but also to connect with one another. Hashtag Occupati incites people to witness each other's experiences of oppression and share their own. Hashtag Occupati creates and provides access to a visual culture of belonging, while also encouraging on-site activism. Both Carnes and Hughes explain that their selfies are really planned out. They often involve friends, props, and careful location selection. Therefore, the images tagged with Occupati are not so much impromptu selfies as they are collective and creative co-productions of knowledge and experience in public bathrooms. So Occupati flies in the face of HB2 as it fosters a sense of community. It can strengthen alliances with allies, as allies are often co-actors in the photos. And it makes trans and genderqueer identity and inequality visible in public space. Okay, so the second action I want to talk about is bathroom graffiti and the ways in which it challenges the exclusionary architecture of gender-segregated bathrooms, rather than overtly protesting laws and legislation. So, although there are obviously graffiti inscriptions that do just that. Public space is a built environment. Architects plot, plan, and build structures that allow or prohibit particular bodies' entry to or usage of a certain space. Exclusionary architecture is made manifest through racist, ableist, homophobic, and sexist ideologies that shape and inform the construction of space. Architectural practices such as these seek to police and regulate marginalized communities. So the social construction of typical Western public bathrooms condition hetero and cis sexist ideas of the body and sexuality, not only through laws and legislation, but also through architectural design. The design of public bathrooms itself sanctions surveillance of gender and reinforces heteronormativity. So for instance, prior to entering the bathroom, we have these signposts that signify gender segregation, and they require people to conform to a binary. Once past these signs, there are more insidious modes of surveillance operating inside the bathroom, and scholar Sheila Cavanaugh calls these the architecture of exclusion. So one example is the height of toilets and urinals, where there's a distance between genitals and receptacle, so there you can hear it. There's an acoustic means, a way to discern gender difference based on the height of the toilets. And the many reflective surfaces, tiles, glass, glossy paint, mirrors, and low-cut stall partitions all enhance the public's ability to code gender and sexuality. This truly panopticon, panopticon environment is used to closet and threaten to uncloset non-normative gender and gives others a sense of entitlement to interrogate and police the presence of queer sexuality and gender. Queer bathroom graffiti both resists and disrupts the architecture of exclusion. Graffiti becomes a part of the bathroom's aesthetic, invading the material space and intervening in the heteronormative organization of bodies. Queer bathroom graffiti calls into question the invisibility of queer sexuality in everyday space. The political potential of queer bathroom graffiti as a form of direct action is not just that it affords queers to come out of or expose the public bathroom as a closeted space by writing something like, "We're here and we're queer" on the wall. Rather, the affective interactions with the materiality of graffiti, that is the ink, paint, stickers, and scratches on the stall's wall, change the architectural aesthetic and thus the way bodies encounter the space. So there's a visceral experience of writing on public surfaces and thus into a space. And it connects the self and material world as well as the private and public, and at the same time, it has the potential to collapse those distinctions, allowing the graffiti writer to inhabit and transform the bathroom space in new autonomous ways. Writing graffiti in public bathroom changes our relationship to the environment. It subverts, if only for an instance, the pain of exclusion inflicted by the highly sanitized and surveillant atmosphere. Instead, bathroom graffiti offers a sort of pleasure, a physical thrill or adrenaline rush of holding a spray can or seeing words and images take shape, sensing the smooth or bumpy surface through a marker, and feeling how the ink forms on the stall wall. In this way, public bathrooms are never just looked upon and avoided so much as they are felt, lived, and occupied. A bathroom stall with multiple queer graffiti inscriptions sprawled on the walls recalls the multiplicity of different queer bodies that wrote and will write graffiti and therefore moved and will move through space. Queer bathroom graffiti conjoins and infuses different queer bodies, allowing them to touch each other across time. Queer bathroom graffiti can be a haunting reminder of homophobic violence in public bathrooms, and at the same time, it may form an effective archive that traces queer sex in public. Queer bathroom graffiti transforms the architecture of exclusion, which is a clean, sterilized, gender-oppressive, anxious space, to an architecture of inclusion, a queer, creative, indeterminate place full of possibilities. Bathroom graffiti and subversive selfies are powerful actions of resistance that are often overlooked. What I've hoped to show here today is that both actions mark out queer and trans presence in cis-sexist space while also changing our experience and feeling of public bathrooms. The media actions are autonomous, they do not ask for state permission, they can happen anytime, in any washroom, by anyone. They are ephemeral, yet relatively accessible. They reclaim exclusionary space and encourage community building through creative queer occupation. In doing so, they open a space for us to think through and expand on the radical political potentials that queer media activism has to offer. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, folks. And I'll grab a seat and we can get away from it. Oh, God.
Should I do something else?
No, it's okay. Okay.
Maybe we'll just go to Mark's room.
I don't.
Okay.
No,
it doesn't
work.
Oh, all right. No worries. Actually, you know, why don't we just keep it surrounded like this? So, just to let you know, I was taking a few notes from the presentations just because they asked me to do so. So apologies if there's a lot of half sentences that kind of just stop midway through when I wasn't able to follow what fully you're saying, but I've tried the best to give the gist of your presentations. So again, I was hoping we could maybe have a discussion around this. One of the things that I'd like to start off with as chair is I just want to talk a little bit about those other voices in terms of your projects. So. Andrea just kind of talked about tagging and selfie culture around the kind of Occupy movement and graffiti. And one of the things that she pointed out is the images that we see up there are pretty standard. Everyone in the room right now is white. No more potlucks, you'd mentioned, kind of started off that way at least and has tried to expand voices. And Luke, you'd mentioned that as well, kind of in your project. One of the things I wanted to start off with is how do you folks either do outreach to try to reach other communities or bring in other voices? You know, how do you think that could be done or how do you think other communities can be engaged like that in terms of kind of some of the like hashtagging or kind of movement building that happens on those issues. Why don't we start with you, Luke?
Okay, sure.
Yeah, why don't we grab the mic and pass it around? Oh, you know what? I'll just
screen and hear us as well.
Excellent. So this is really something that we've incredibly struggled with. Our show is doing the lunchtime drive, which is fantastic. It means we reach a wide public audience, and there's definitely a great benefit and privilege to having that particular time slot. However, the consequence of that is that we have to be incredibly privileged in order to be able to be available at Thursday at 1 p.m. I mean, thankfully, I've got a job where I can get up and leave for 2 hours and then come back. And my co-hosts are academics where they can wander upstairs to the station. But in order to gauge with folks who aren't white and cisgendered, we're often talking about people to in the working poor is people who are busy trying to make ends meet, and it makes it very difficult to find folks to be able to be available. And that's one of the barriers that we face, because I firmly believe that we need to go to where folks are and meet them where they're at in order to engage them instead of, you know, expecting them to come to us. But the problems that creates is having the time and the capacity to go out and actively engage with communities, which is something that's a volunteer project is very difficult to do. So we're hoping to improve. But there are definitely some systemic barriers that have made it very difficult to actually reach out to these communities.
Have you tried anything?
Well, when I had a bit more time on my hands, we would be at constantly at various events. As you mentioned, you build up a network in the community of doing radio, knowing like the local theater production to the service providers. And so we know where everybody is. But it's going into these communities and engaging them like, you know, we have a platform. We'd like to highlight topics that you want to come up with. Having the time to go and have that conversation is currently the biggest barrier that we face.
Sorry, I'll just go with the circle, but then we'll go back. You'll get a starting shot later.
So I guess for an MP, I wouldn't say that we started off white. That makes it sound weird. Definitely not. The first cover was a white person.
Mormon, your collective?
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah.
You said it was like a project of three people? Or?
Yeah. So, yeah, we're three plus other sort of people coming and going. You know, within that whiteness, there have been, at some point, we were equal part trans and cisgendered. So it's all sort of how that gets divvied up in some ways. Some of the efforts that we've made, and it's not like we're totally comfortable with this, but at some point we just decided we would have no white people as cover photographers, you know, for the last, you know, years and until the end of NMP. You know, is that just sort of a random choice? At some point you just have to sort of make that commitment, and then it does bring about pretty amazing things. Another strategy we've used is, you know, bring in people of color and then bringing in, you know, asking sort of, you know, we have every year we have a guest curated issue, and so also reserve for, you know, queer women of color in particular. So it's sort of those kinds of sustained efforts, which we hope sidestep tokenism, because it's sort of a long-term, you know, a long-term sustained effort. So I think those are the two ways that we really sort of implement that sort of and acknowledge that lack.
Yeah, I'd say, and part of that is making an effort to build alliances with other movements, you know, to incorporate individuals in other activist movements or social movements into NMP, right, that might not be, to someone's definition of queer, right? But we let sort of contributors, I guess, figure that out if they align or misalign or whatever. So that's kind of what is really important for us.
So I'm not a collective, but my dissertation work, and this is certainly part of it, although the hashtag Occupati is relatively a new venture for me, but I look at a number of different queer public artworks and their autonomous tactics that are anti-authoritarian. So in part of doing that, it's really been important for me to reach out to the artists, but also their networks and their supports, and I think, again, building alliances, like Andrea, I don't know how you pronounce it, said, is really important to find out what other movements can be pulled in or already has existing connections that you're unaware of, and then build out from there and really communicate with the community. As a cisgender woman talking about trans issues quite frequently, it's really important for me to have constant dialogue with folks in that community, for sure.
Sorry. So I do have another question I want to ask, but before I do, anyone else want to ask something? A couple of our other laptop folks, either of you want to have something you want to ask? Gonna see the stares of no? Nothing at all? Yeah, shoot.
So you spoke about the other journals and them kind of being offshoots and networking, and I was wondering if you could just talk a little bit more about what you think the importance is building some kind of visible network online of queer feminist academic journals or non-academic journals or journals that are doing both.
I think in part when I was doing my master's, actually, I was doing it on archiving absence, and it was very much about sort of, in Canada in particular, a lot of the archives, so you had the Women's Movement Archive that's now at the University of Ottawa, and this might turn into a bit of a long story, but basically, so the sort of the archival policies of particular social movements were really reflected sort of, you know, in those social movements. So you had the Women's Movement Archive of Ottawa. It was very inaccessible and was all sort of deemed personal correspondence, and so, you know, in 100 years you could get to it. Whereas the GLBT archive in Toronto, which was mainly the gay archive, and the L was tacked on, you know, to get more funding, they were very much about outing, like just go out people. It's, you know, it's sort of nobody's responsibility. So the ethics were very, very different. And so I think taking a little bit of that into this is sort of, well, if you don't sort of represent yourself, maybe no one else will do it, or will, you know, sort of fall into sort of that absence or into lumped into a community that you don't necessarily always feel part of or welcome in, right? And so, and I think these offshoots like Feral Feminism or Fembot or all of this, I think it's because NMP could never claim to represent everyone, nor would we want that responsibility, honestly. So it's great that these other journals appear and you know, can sort of create other parallel archives or, you know, so I don't know if that answers your question, but that's sort of the way I see it.
I had a question. When you were speaking, you mentioned something about, all I've got written down here is a note on the false paradigm of unity, this assumption that the GLBT community is a homogenous group that operates with a single hive mind, and we see that in usually around conversations around gay marriage is particularly where that kind of surfaces. Is that something that you've kind of been butting up against? This assumption that all GLBT folks are the same within the heteronormative world?
I would say, you know, the reading of NMP's certain articles would definitely, I would say, are politically, we're probably aligned with resisting a lot of that homonormative. I feel like that exists elsewhere, and that is like that radio show, the sort of top 40. There's enough visibility around that, and there's sort of enough support around that. So we definitely tend to, you know, we're not an unbiased journal. No such thing exists, but we're basically picking up the voice counter to some of that.
And I think And connecting your two questions a little bit in terms of butting up against a definition, and then I can't remember the question, Andy, but this.
The
Yes, visible and extra. Thank you. I think, like, we're also working in creating an accessible space online so that, that counters, like, the commodified web or the commercialized web. And so making or having alliances with these other journals or publications or whatever are part of that other layer, other kind of community layer, right, that in building these alliances. So I don't think, I mean, it's interesting to trace these relationships or, you know, how things, certain groups inform other groups, and that's sort of part of the work that we do. Anyway, we need to make those relationships clear too, so.
So it was funny, I was involved actually mostly with like queer media in the late 90s and early 2000s. And then got into kind of other stuff and really wasn't reporting it on anymore. And I recently wrote an article and somebody was like, it was funny, it was kind of like in the year 2000, using the word transgendered wasn't as problematic, or it was okay in some style guidelines. and somebody was like, "Oh, yeah, it's totally wrong, dude. You're gonna bother some people." And I checked the style guidelines, but I was also kind of like, "Wow, a lot has changed in 10 years that I hadn't really realized in terms of the nuance of some of the discussions." As in the topics of what was around, you know, I pulled out kind of like an Out magazine from 1999 and was kind of shocked by some of the editorial transphobia in there, you know, that had counterpoints, but I was just like, I don't think you could get away with printing it today as kind of like an opinion piece. And I was just, I guess, wondering, you know, I think, Luke, you had mentioned kind of some certain news topics that were specific and current. I think you've seen certain kind of different types of graffiti that kind of go beyond maybe just the kind of topic that you're studying. And you folks seem to have a host of topics. I was wondering what you folks feel are kind of the more common discussions that are happening today around these issues in queer and trans media.
Please go ahead.
I still need to think.
Well, I mean, yeah, I don't know. I don't know if we can put it into like a few key terms. I think what, and especially how we operate and what, who or what we try to engage, is that it's actually trying to do the opposite of like being able to neatly define topics. I mean, certainly there are trends, and I'm sure we can map these trends and find trends. Was that a very lazy way of escaping your? I think I just really tried to diffract your question. That's what I just did there. No, I don't. I yeah. I think
what
that's.
What would be the trends that you think would happen? I mean,
yeah.
I was shocked recently that I was on Tinder. The amount of guys on the machine kind of like intersectional feminism.
Okay.
And I was
oh,
like,
yeah,
well, when did this happen? I was more used to, you know, mask, mask seeks mask is my framework that it seems to be, and now it's like, what? So, again, I'm kind of looking at
it. Well, I think that's it. I think maybe the question of race is more at the forefront now as it intersects with queer, and I would say because we grew out of Montreal language, we had much more francophone content when we started. That's actually been very hard to sort of bring in because you need copy editors, you need, you know, that it's sort of its own, in Montreal anyway, the francophone community and the anglophone community, they overlap, but they're very distinct, right? So language, I would say, is one of those sort of issues. And then in language, there's obviously the language. So queer is not a word that's easily said in French or used. Politics around transsexuality and transgenderism are very, very different in Francophone, Montreal, than Anglophone Montreal, almost, you know, conflicting. So so I would say very sort of local, regional, queer debates and politics, no unifying Canadian thing. And I think that's sort of, hard to bring into a journal. I think it's sort of a debate that we know from sort of being part of a community, but not always, people aren't always, you know, a few people like to write provocative, you know, take a stand kind of pieces for NMP, but I would say most people have those debates in more private sort of settings still. So I think it's a great question, though. It's like tracking that. It would be nice to look at NMP and actually see over the last 7 years sort of what has changed, what's been interesting, and also sort of what those debates have been. I think it's a great question.
I think I've seen, because, I mean, when I think back to the days of three gays in the radio, which at one point was two lesbians as well, so we're like, we really should rename this. This isn't working. But no, two bisexual women, that was it. But looking back then, you know, I remember we did an episode on what is asexuality, and it was kind of those early days feelers exploring topics. But now we're tackling things like the Canadian environment for Syrian GLBT refugees. Like, how do you, you know, connect with the community and a community in Canada that is racist? Like, how do you break down those barriers? Folks who are fleeing incredible violence, but then encountering a totally different type of violence once they get to Canada. So, I mean, there are very Canadian examples, and I disagree. I think there are Canadian topics that are at the national level. Bill C-279 and the Senator Platt stalling, and I mean, those are great conversations that were being had simultaneously across the country, and I think that really speaks to the incredible trans lobbying effort that was a conversation happening nationally. But I mean, I got a phone call from somebody in the community development part of the Ottawa Police asking me, you know, we want to do hate crimes or same-sex intimate-partner violence, which one do we choose? What's the cause du jour? Because we need to pick one for our speaker series. And I'm like, well, I mean, they're both highly underreported. They're both issues that definitely need to be talked about in the public, in the open. And so, I mean, it'd be difficult to choose one, and that's a ridiculous proposition to have to choose one. Thank you for putting me in this position. But no, there are certainly topics still today that are going unspoken, and I think intimate partner violence in the GLBT community is certainly one that really needs more of a light on it. And Canadians, it's not all sunshine and rainbows. Like, I mean, in Ottawa, just 6 months ago, there was three weekends in a row somebody was beaten up outside of a gay bar, to the point that the Ottawa Police had to send in multiple cruisers and patrol for every hour of the day for 3 weeks to kind of curb that behavior. So, I mean, it's not all sunshine, even in Canada. There are various serious issues that we need to look at. But I think the issues have become incredibly more nuanced than they may have been a few years ago.
So I just have something short and quick. Focusing on the topic of bathroom graffiti has been a little bit of a struggle with advisors and whatnot. But I think it's important to throw it into the mix of some of the more kind of neoliberal agendas or what have you, to really look at some of the things that are being done on the ground and to the environment itself that's being talked about. So in terms of taking bathroom graffiti as an object to study, it's also been really interesting because, of course, in bathrooms there's a lot of homophobic graffiti. And so dealing with that tension has been a struggle, and also talking to folks about how they feel, how that affects them versus, you know, queer positive graffiti. And so I'm still kind of working through those tensions, but I try not to show them, but I'm going to definitely have to deal with that tension at some point. And same with the Occupati pictures. The comments, you know, are not always great, as the internet does. So, yeah, there's definitely some heat even around these kind of topics that we don't normally talk about, like bathroom graffiti. Yeah.
Any other questions? OK, Okay, folks, we're 20 minutes out. We could do some more discussion, but also it's early in the morning, so I would maybe just suggest that we continue the conversation, some other things that we got get here. One of the things that I found... Oh, sir, can you pass this? Sorry.
So we're going to wrap up, but before we do, one of the things that I found very interesting, because I go to a lot of workshops and conferences, but you don't always see this, was the kind of red thread that's kind of running through a lot of your presentations in terms of themes, ideas around access, ideas around, even some of the photos that I think you folks used were kind of similar. So I thought that was really cool, and I'd really appreciate if you could bring those themes into some of the other presentations that we have. Because again, one of the best things about conferences like this is that we get to Skillshare and learn from each other, pick up new ideas and frameworks from doing the work that we do, including things like social media and trying to bring that in. You know, that was a discussion last night for the kind of opening panel where they talked about the kind of pros and cons of social media, and some of you work in that exclusively. But also some of the specific things that you've done in your projects, I think, have been probably path-breaking for a lot of people that are running on fumes and trying to put together publications and media projects with duct tape and glue. So again, some of your expertise, and that's great. Pick up some coffee, and have a great day. Thanks for coming up.